Thank you, everyone, for joining World Footprints again on our Building Bridges Across Social Distancing series. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick. My husband and co-host Ian is right behind me working, and we're very pleased to share the stories from another guest, someone who we met recently. And we know he has some really interesting stories to bring us from Belgium. Sven Parthie is a massage therapist and life coach with a focus on stress management and stress reduction. He was born in Germany. He has a very eclectic educational background ranging from constitutional law to medieval and modern history and English philosophy. And Sven has been living in Brussels for the last 15 years, and he said the coronavirus is the second time he has experienced this level of discomfort and anxiety in Brussels, where he lives. The first time being the terrorism attack in 2016. And so we welcome him to World Footprints. Sven, thank you so much for joining us this evening.
Hello, and thank you for having me. So.
It's our pleasure. I know it's late there, so we appreciate you staying up.
Yeah, no problem. Anything for you.
Bless you. So let me ask first, how are you, and how is your girlfriend, Anna, who we also had the pleasure of meeting? How are you doing?
We are both doing fine. Of course, staying in social distance. We are not living together, so not seeing a lot of each other. So, but otherwise, we are both doing fine, health-wise at least. And yeah, so my business is closed, at least to the massage part. Still try to do some online coaching. But apart from the kind of business aspects, we are not affected right now.
Good. And so I know the business aspect is one of the impacts that you've experienced because of this coronavirus. How are you coping with it? And have you found some creative ways in order to cope with the social distancing and business closures? What are you doing?
Well, there is now the first measures by the Belgian government that you can apply for concerning social contributions, delays in tax payments, etc. So you have to figure that out. You can work on that to try to do some business development, so use the time productively that you don't spend with clients right now. Concerning developing online coaching, starting to write articles and short notes and tips for how to handle the isolation at home, how to stay away from too much news coverage in order not to heighten anxiety, something that was kind of studied also after 9/11, where people worldwide were kind of even traumatized by watching the planes again and again, and constant news coverage, media coverage. So you should, you know, trying to stay away from that, trying to help people with that. Also, some clients of mine started to book their massages or pay for massages in advance. I have like abonnements or subscription systems that they now kind of subscribe to in advance to help out as much as they can. Mm-hmm. So there's some ways of trying to mitigate the whole thing.
And you know, and I was gonna ask you about your massage therapy business. First, I didn't realize, because I would have taken advantage when we met, you know, stiff shoulders and all. But for someone, you know, obviously you cannot have clients at this particular time. Is there anything that you advise your clients to do in order to keep circulation going? I mean, are there self-massage things they can do in the interim?
You can do self-massage. It's usually advisable to do some stretching, to do some kinds of other sports that you can do. We are still allowed to, you are allowed to go get out in Brussels. So that's not like a complete lockdown. You're allowed to go out on your own, or if you keep the distance with a friend, or of course people who are living with you, so families can get out together, but otherwise maximum two people and keeping the distance. You can go for a run, you can go for a walk, and right now I'm kind of advising that as well, to be as healthy as you can, to keep your immune system up to speed, because that's what you need if you really get infected in the end, and also to keep away from hospitals. Even if you don't get the virus, you might get fall sick otherwise. And right now the weather is really good in Brussels. We had some sunshine, it's not too cold. So get out, get as much vitamin D as you can, go for a walk, keep the circulation up is already helpful. Also, what is different or difficult to do, especially when you're not used to this, when you're alone at home or even with your partner, still make sure you get your sleep. That's one of the most important things also for keeping your muscles ready and not getting too stiff, and your immune system just needs the sleep as well. So these are the things that you really can try to put in place. It's not easy when you're used to go to an office. You have kind of the exercise of going there, coming back. Yeah, you can feel more exhausted. Mm-hmm. So trying to get to this point that you're kind of doing something at home rather than just binge watching Netflix or something like that, because then you won't get as tired as you were normally. So you will not sleep that well. You will feel exhausted in the morning instead of refreshed. Mm-hmm. So that's something that you really can do.
Now, you know, we know a lot of people, because we're probably a good majority, if not the entire world, is on lockdown or, social distancing intentionally at home. And so there's a lot of time on many people's hands. And you say that as part of your anxiety reduction and training and the anxiety surrounding isolation, one of the things you have said, I believe, is that you help people organize their home office.
Yeah.
How is that an anxiety reducer?
Well, when you go to your office and you kind of, you get back from work, normally you have the feeling you have something accomplished. When you set up your home office and you don't get running, so you don't really feel that you're accomplishing anything, often that's there's kind of two ways of looking at that. The one thing is that you need time to set this up properly. There's a lot of roadblocks anywhere and a lot of distractions that you are not used to while normally working. So you should give yourself a bit of slack there. Mm-hmm. So rather kind of, don't think that you will be as productive immediately in a new space you are in your normal office environment or whatever. And then so trying to help with that. Also kind of in general, trying to use, for example, your laptop rather than the normal desktop PC you might have at home, or vice versa, so that you have really one device at home that you're working on and another one for pleasure and distraction. So these small things can really help. There's techniques you can use that are normally from productivity coaching, like the so-called Pomodoro technique, where you would use 25 minutes to focus on one certain topic, or you can, and then have a 5 minutes break, and then you can have another 25 minutes, but really block out everything else. Mm-hmm. And then afterwards, so kind of to get either started You can also use that to get rid of certain distractions, like if you kind of have the problem that you're constantly looking at your emails, you can also say, well, I'm taking 25 minutes now for the emails and then I'm done till the evening with that. So that's
hard for people like me.
yeah, but it also depends on your setting. Like when I have a normal working environment, I'm constantly getting new requests for massage appointments or for coaching appointments. So you want to deal with that as soon as possible. So it's not really working for me to not looking at emails throughout the day, but you can try to limit that anyway. So or kind of do away with the things that are not meeting requests or something like that.
So I want to learn a little bit more about what you're seeing in Brussels. You know, we know when we have, and we've seen many times when we've had national emergencies, or I mean, in this case, global pandemic, the best of people, for the most part, really comes out, and you find neighbors helping neighbors and strangers helping, you know, strangers. What acts of kindness have you observed, experienced, or even offered over the last few weeks?
Well, I mean, this is very different to what we had with the terror attacks. It's still, you have very empty streets, but people are calm. So with the terror attacks, of course, people were much more anxious, much more unnerved, more nervous going around. But still, there was a huge sense of solidarity and being together. So getting out, going to remembrance marches or to have a minute of remembrance, of silence, to do this. That's the same a bit right now. All over Europe, people started to applaud the healthcare services at 8 p.m. every evening, which is a nice thing because then in your street, you can really, when I forget about that, I hear it immediately. It's very loud, so especially because there's not a lot of cars going around right now, so you have really this feeling of connecting with the people around you just by applauding for the healthcare workers. And
this is across Europe,
so I think it started in Spain or something. It's been done in Brussels or in Belgium since last week Thursday, I think.
Well, I know in Paris they light the Eiffel Tower in recognition and honor of healthcare workers.
Yeah, so, but that's one thing that is done collectively. Then, for example, one of my neighbors just moved in. I gave her my Wi-Fi password via WhatsApp to kind of, you know, so she's not alone now in this situation without any connection to the internet, or not at least not without kind of needing a phone plan. There's a lot of people who are offering to help out old people, to volunteering for blood donations. You have also these things all happen. As I said, my clients already kind of, some of them paid in advance in order to make to help me with that. So yes, there's a lot of ways how to help people out. I kind of, if you can, you try to buy stuff from the local grocery shop, if you can, if that's feasible. So yeah, in general, I have the feeling people are really coming together where they can.
So yes, yeah, for sure. And so have you, other than what we're doing now on Zoom, have you found other creative ways to connect with people? I know you mentioned the clapping at 8 o'clock is a way that you connect really across Europe. But you yourself, have you found some creative ways to keep in touch with your friends, your family?
Yeah, so of course you stay on the phone and et cetera, but what you can do here right now and what I've done now for the week is to kind of meet with friends, or kind of to find kind of make an appointment for going on a walk. Depend, you know, kind of like depends whether we can, like on Friday, it's the birthday of a close friend of mine. So we'll meet at some time in the evening for walking around. With female friends, it feels a bit like 19th century courtship rituals. You kind of, you meet with a 1.50 meter a distance, or you're 6 feet. And then it's like, it sounds like a Jane Austen novel in a way. So, but it's so you can think about it also in funny ways and in creative ways. So that's helpful. Otherwise, sending letters, writing letters as well. Just started writing a letter to a friend from Germany. So yeah, trying to do that.
And that's the lost art, the art of writing letters.
It's
people
truly,
don't do that anymore.
Yeah, and it's a very different process. It's much more, you know, whenever I sit down, and sometimes I'm also writing kind of short stories or something like that, you often feel when you kind of put pen to paper, it feels different. It's a very different process. So it can also be helpful for that.
Yes. So when this thing is all said and done, when the pandemic is over, when social distancing and isolation have been lifted, what's the first thing you're going to do, or first place you're going to go?
Well, the thing is, with my experience from this terror attacks, I think it will not be one moment to the other. But what you really will miss and what you really want to do at the end is just to hug people, because you will miss this, especially when you're living on your own, you will miss this physical contact. Mm-hmm. You know, you can connect as much as you want to through kind of phone or video or something like that. But just this feeling of getting hugged will be something that you definitely miss. The other thing will be to go to a cafe and just have a coffee outside or something like that, and enjoy that feeling.
Oh, well, my friend, I'm sending you a virtual hug.
Thank you.
And I
sending that back from Belgium. So.
Oh, I accept. We both do. And I thank you so much for spending time with me tonight to share your story and some really good tips. I really appreciate some of the tips that you shared.
You're welcome. Pleasure to have been on your podcast. So.